Today I'm going to be sharing how I turned a picture of my cat into this cute little 3D printed figurine. Not only that, but I would argue that this is also a pretty good business idea if you want to make some money on the side. For this, we are going to be using today's sponsor, Python 3D, which is an AI tool that turns pictures into 3D models. First and foremost, we're going to be needing at least one picture of my cat, as any pet owner I have a lot. And we also need to take into account Python 3D's best practices. They recommend that your image has a clear focus, that it has a very clean background, that there's a single subject, and that the subject is being shown completely in that picture. Which, to be honest, is a bit hard when we are talking about real life pictures, but that's where image editing comes to our rescue. Here's the picture that we are going to be turning into a 3D model using Hidden 3D. When talking about real life pictures, we want to remove the background and make the image as clean as we can. For this one, I already did it. If I hide the background, here's just my cat in a box, and I try my best to make the edges super clean and so on, so that we can get a good model at the end. Now, how do you do that? You can either use a background remover or you can select it yourself. So here in Affinity, they have this AI-powered object selection tool that already helps a lot. As you can see, it's already highlighting my previous dog here. Her name was Mel. And then we can refine. And this is where we will be doing most of our work. You see that she has this scarf on that's it wasn't captured. Then we can just brush over it and make sure that everything's there. So yeah, the two main settings I would change here is the matte edges. And then I would turn on smoothing a little bit. And then we can try it on other preview backgrounds. Make sure that we're capturing what we want. Here on her paw, for example, we have some bleed, and then remove it. Another setting that might help a little bit is ramp. So we set it to negative, it will remove a little bit of the edges. And then we can duplicate, and we can export that and import it into Hidden 3D. So here we are in Hidden 3D. We are going to be using their newest 1536 Pro model. Since our end goal here is to 3D print the models, I would recommend for you to leave the texture off. And then we can upload our picture here. And then click on generate. And we are doing the same thing with the picture of my cat. So we are going to be using their 1536 Pro model, and we'll be leaving the texture off. This will take a little bit of time, but don't worry, it's on the queue and it's going to be processed. As you can see, I have tried generating models with texture before, but usually what happens, this is very good if you're working with game development or something like that, but for 3D printing, it's not really necessary. And not only that, in my experience, I've found that it's usually creating a couple of gaps in the model that aren't really there when we turn textures off. I'm not sure why, but that has been my experience. So that's why I recommend turning textures off when we are trying to create models for 3D printing. So here is the final model for Mel. I wouldn't say this is print ready. It generated quite a few weird artifacts around the model, as you can see. We are asking a bit too much of the AI, I would say, to be able to create a 3D model from her in this position specifically. You could definitely try to 3D print this, but it would take more work in terms of post-processing and removing these weird artifacts. Here's the final result for Shiku. As you can see, it looks quite nice, actually. If we try to look inside the box, it's kind of random because the AI doesn't know what's inside there. It's not, I would say, a best practice because there's more than one thing in the picture, it's not just the cat. But I thought it would be cute to have him sit inside the box. As you can see, it's interesting because the amount of detail that we asked for, it even started doing some of the fur here on his forehead. Now, let's see if we can export this and 3D print it. As you can see here on the bottom right corner, we have the number of vertices, the number of faces, the model that we used in the resolution. And now we are going to choose the format, which would be STL for 3D printing, and download it. Hey, Lucas from the future here. So you might have noticed that the generated model is a bit too smooth, and the Hidden 3D team is already aware of that, and they are working on improvements, okay? So hopefully in the future, you get even better results than I got this time. As I am opening the file here in Orca Slicer, As you can see, it gives us a warning because the file is too small. And that's because the AI doesn't have like any size reference. So it's kind of random. So every time you will need to scale it. This time I will confirm that it should scale to millimeters, but we will have to scale it manually afterwards anyway. As you can see, the box is also not oriented correctly. So I'll also click on the layout face option and click on the bottom of the box. And now it's pretty nicely placed. And as I mentioned before, I'll just scale it up a little bit and make sure it's centered. So unfortunately, the box is too thin to be printed currently. Otherwise, besides like the amount of supports that are needed, it looks fine, to be honest. As you can see, the bottom of the box is not exactly flat either. So I would like push the model against the base a little bit just so that we can get like a perfectly flat base. Okay, so here's how I made the cardboard box printable. Basically, I took the Hidden 3D model into Blender and then I applied two modifiers. First, I did the solidify modifier that's meant to add the thickness to the cardboard box. And then just to be 100% sure that it would be fine, I also did a voxel remesh. And I played around a little bit with the voxel size and the thickness here to get a good amount of detail and add a good amount of thickness as well. And now, like after slicing it, it seems pretty good. The cardboard box, like it's thick enough. And we have a good base to start printing the model on. So I'll send this one to the printer and let's see how it turns out. Here's how the model turned out. As you can see, like the color it tried to print but failed because it was so small. And there's this like kind of weird line here, but this was on the slicer, so it's not a print defect. I'm not sure how to fix it, but it's not too annoying, I would say. Overall, it turned out really good. At the beginning of the video, I mentioned how this could be a good business idea, but in order to consider that, we have to talk about pricing. So, Hitem3D pricing is pretty straightforward. They have three tiers. The first one is free, kind of like a free trial. The second one is $20 a month, and the third one is $40 a month. All of them grant you commercial usage for the models that you produce, and your models are also private. Basically, the only difference between the tiers, apart from the price, is the amount of credits that you get, which in practice just means the number of models that you'll be able to generate, and the queue priority. They say the free tier can generate around 10 models, the $20 version can create around 100 models, and the $40 one can create around 240 models. You can always purchase more credits, but it's important to know that unused credits will not carry over to the next month because it is a subscription. If you want to try Hitem3D out for yourself, the link will be in the description. And let me know in the comments what do you think about it, and if you have any questions, I'll try my best to answer them. But I guess that's it for today. See you guys next time.